Welcome to our first Tree Mob of 2021. I'm Pam Thompson, Manager of Adult Education for the Arnold Arboretum. And sadly, we still aren't gathering in the landscape. However, this format allows many more of you to participate and learn from us, which I'm very grateful for. Our speaker today is Brendan Keegan, and he is Arnold Arboretum Horticulturist. He has worked at the Arboretum since May of 2016, where his primary responsibilities include general landscaping, hardscaping, turf management, and irrigation installation. He's keenly interested in cultivating the Arboretum's value as an urban habitat that is beneficial to both humans and animals. He's involved with various bird projects on site and the planting of native wildflowers in our meadow to benefit insects and birds. Prior to joining the team at the Arboretum, Brendan served for 2 years as a Peace Corps volunteer in Ukraine and spent a year in Belize working with a sustainable agricultural NGO. Today, Brendan is speaking to us about urban owls. So welcome, Brendan.
All right, thanks, Pam. All right, so as Pam just mentioned, and as you all hopefully know, the purpose of this talk today is just to go over the nesting habits of specifically of great horned owls in the Arnold Arboretum. Great, so kind of what we're gonna cover today, a broad outline. So we're gonna be talking first off about owling ethics. So when we're looking at owls in the landscape or when you might be visiting the landscape to do some owling, some of our institutional guidelines for photographing and observing owls. We'll do some brief species background for people that may not be familiar with great horned owls, so go over a little bit about their habitat, their diet, distribution. We're going to talk about the courtship and nest selection, so how these owls start mating around this time of year and what kind of processes that goes through. And then we'll end with some photos of raising owlets. And I think it's important to note that all the photos in this presentation, none of them are current. So if you're looking at this and you're you know, perhaps excitedly wondering where the nests are, these are all old photos. So these are, you know, the earliest from last year and then from many years before. So in this presentation, I will not be disclosing the exact location of any of our nest or roosting sites for owls. So if you know where they are, that's great, but please don't ask in the questions, because I'm not going to disclose where the locations are, which leads me just into talking about our owling guidelines or kind of our owling ethics. So the reason I'm not going to disclose where the nest sites are or where the owls can be found exactly in the arboretum is really just out of respect for the wildlife and trying to make this the safest place as possible for these creatures. Obviously, we're in an urban area, and one of the benefits of being in an urban area is that, you know, people can walk and can see wildlife essentially in their own backyards. We have such a diversity of birds, of mammals that are often go underappreciated in the arboretum. But on the other hand, we're surrounded by so many people that if you highlight a specific animal that people find interesting, such as owls, it can lead to this inundation of attention that's often not very good for the wildlife either. So if you've been in the landscape recently, you perhaps have seen these signs, you know, saying do not disturb. Again, these are just for the benefit and to protect the species that we are lucky and fortunate to have here. So some of the arboretum's guidelines for owls in particular is that the arboretum as an institution does not post recent photos of owls to social media. We don't post active nest photos to social media. And the reason for that is that for all the educational benefits that social media provides, it just opens the door for so many people to see and to appreciate these animals, but unfortunately for a ton of people to also come and try and find them themselves. And while we're not trying to discourage people from observing wildlife respectfully, we also don't want to encourage, you know, too many people to come to the landscape, especially at a time of year that is really kind of delicate for these species and where it's important for them to have peace and quiet from potential predators, which include us. Some other guidelines, if you're in the landscape looking for owls, which, you know, of course would encourage you to do, is not to play recording. So don't play back mating calls in an attempt to locate them. This can distress them or confuse them. If you do find an owl, to speak softly and to walk slowly. So don't, you know, jump up and down trying to get it to move, or yell at it trying to get it into a better photographic position. If you find a good roost site or a nest site, I encourage you to visit infrequently. And that's just, you know, out of consideration of the impact of many visits by many people. So again, in an urban area, if you found a nest site or if you found an owl, there's chances are that a lot of other people have done the same thing. And so it might not seem very much for you to come every day, for example, for 10 minutes. But if you factor in that there could be 100 people doing the exact same thing every day, the impact on the wildlife and specifically on owls that are trying to hide, that they're trying to have this time to raise, to start a nest and then to raise owlets, the cumulative impact, on the species is probably not good. So we can talk more about that in the question and answer, but these are just the Arboretum's guidelines for owling in particular. So if you're not familiar with great horned owls, this is an example. So this is, most of the photos taken here again are from the Arboretum, but from previous years. And I think I've credited everyone who's provided, very kindly provided these photos. So this is an example. This is a great horned owl. As you can see, it has these very characteristic horns. We'll see some other close-ups later, but these actually aren't horns. These are just feathers that the owl raises on its head. The idea is that, you know, perhaps these are used for communication. Like if you have a dog or a cat, you know, they might change the way their ears are raised to communicate happiness or unhappiness. In this case, owls also use their tufts or their horns for camouflage. So they raise up their tufts essentially to try and break the outline of their heads. So if you imagine without these ears, you might have this very clear line right around this owl's body. It'd make it easier for them to see. So most owls have these, have some kind of, or many owls have some kind of horn. And one of the theories is that they use it to break up their outlines and help them to be better camouflaged. Other characteristics of great horned owls in particular is, of course, they have these really nice kind of barred feathers, kind of this nice alternating orange, browns, and yellows. Great horned owls, a previous common name by early naturalists was actually the tiger owl. And that reflects both the coloration and kind of the patterns of this owl, as well as its character. So if you're looking at this and you think it looks like a particularly fierce animal, then you would be correct. So great horned owls are apex predators, which means that in most of their territories, and especially in Boston, there's no other animal that hunts great horned owls. And great horned owls, as we'll discuss shortly, will hunt and eat just about anything else that they can catch. See other characteristics of owls that are just useful to point out. You see these great big eyes. Owls, of course, have excellent vision, binocular vision essentially. So they hunt, perch just like this guy is up here, staring down and then essentially ambushing their prey. And sometimes people mistake the tufts or these horns for their ears. And these actually don't have any impact on their hearing. The ears for an owl are actually asymmetrically located on its face. And you see this kind of this round feature that's common in many owls. This is referred to as a facial disc. So you can think of the noise from prey, potential prey or potential predator. The owl is, you know, essentially funneling the noise into these ears, which helps it to better locate prey in the environment. Sorry, moving on. So speaking of environment, we'll talk about a little bit about the habitat that great horned owls inhabit. And so it might not be known, but great horned owls are actually you know, the most widely distributed owl species in the United States. You can find them north up into Alaska, the forest of Alaska, south all the way down into Central America. There's actually a subspecies that lives throughout much of South America, all the way to the West Coast, and of course here in the East Coast as well. So they inhabit a wide variety of habitats. They're a truly adaptive species. In the Arboretum, this might be a place that you could look. You know, essentially you'll find them throughout Boston and New England. But what they really like in New England, at least, is kind of edge habitat. So these kind of areas where the tree line opens up to grassy meadows. Urban parks are actually really kind of favored places for great horned owls, again, just because they kind of mimic this edge habitat. They're not necessarily natural. They don't look like forest, but they provide a lot of the same features that they would go for in a more natural ecosystem. And then similarly, again, just highlighting how adaptive this species is. You can find them in the snow up in Alaska, and of course, even into the deserts of the American Southwest. So one of the reasons that they're such an adaptive species is that they eat so many different organisms. So they have the most diverse diet of any North American raptor. Over 500 species have been confirmed, which they prey upon, which is quite a lot. And the arboretum in particular, kind of their most notable prey items are white-footed mice, meadow voles, rabbits, skunks, and probably rats. So people, again, think of owls as being part of nature, you know, something that exists primarily or preferably in these kind of unspoiled forest, whereas the reality is that they'll live wherever they have the habitat to roost, to nest, and then to find food. And urban areas, while they provide kind of their own unique dangers to owls, they also have a lot of benefits, such as a lot of open space for prey items, again, such as rabbits, mice, and voles in particular. This photo here in the this photo right here that looks like a bunch of cotton or fluff, this is actually a white-footed mouse nest that we found this in one of our nest boxes last year. So a little white-footed mouse had filled this nest box completely with milkweed fluff. And if you aren't familiar with milkweed, it's a common pollinator plant and the preferred host plant for monarch butterflies. But this looks like such a comfortable little nest. I like to show it, I guess. So those are just kind of some of the general features of great horned owls. Again, just to highlight some of the main themes, they're very adaptive. They're a very fierce predator, and you can find them just about anywhere in the US. So chances are, if you live in a place that has either forest or big enough parks, you will be able to find great horned owls somewhere in your neighborhood. So next we're gonna talk about courtship and nest selection. And so the reason we're having this tree mob at this time of year is that the fall and the winter are actually kind of the kicking off points for great horned owl nesting. And this is, I think, the earliest of any raptor in North America. So most other raptors, most other songbirds will wait until later in the spring or even into the summer before they start their nesting attempts. But great horned owls prefer to start in the wintertime. So they start looking for mates in the fall. So specifically in around October, November, and definitely into December, you'll see, or more likely you'll hear, owls calling to one another. And I'll pull up a video of their call in just a second. But the call is just kind of like, you know, the quintessential owl call, the hooting. And that typically starts with the male hooting to attract a female. And, you know, it's this really great kind of melodious call. But what the female hears in that is she's assessing his, you know, his strength. She's, you know, listening to how loud he calls, to how long he can call. And she's kind of assessing his vitality as a potential mate based on the strength and the duration of his calling. He's also trying to mark off his territory. So great horned owls defend very large territories for nesting sites. They eat a lot of prey, which means they actually have to have quite large territories to sustain themselves. So they expend a lot of energy hooting as a territorial method to deter other would-be competitors. So again, starting in the fall, the males will start hooting, and it results in this kind of really quite nice sounding duet where the male will call and the female will respond. Great horned owls are monogamous, and they'll often meet up year after year. So they stay faithful to their partner, sometimes for decades until one of them dies. This doesn't necessarily mean that they're entirely faithful. You know, like other monogamous creatures, or supposedly monogamous creatures, great horned owls will mate with non-partners, both the male and the female, when they get the chance. But they will stick with their partner year after year. And as the season goes on and it gets closer and closer to the nesting time, you'll begin to see them roosting closer to potential nest sites. And you also begin to see them roosting closer together. And so this is a pair of owls in the arboretum, a mating pair, that are spending more time together in the landscape. and other kind of typical habits of a mating pair is that the male will begin to bring the female food. Other things you might hear, or if you're very lucky, you might see owls nuzzling each other, rubbing each other's beaks, and even mating. And these are just kind of part of the courtship process. The same thing with calling. So when great horned owl male and female are calling, with again, they're kind of the stereotypical hooting, ornithologists would call that pair bonding. So it's a way of establishing this relationship and kind of establishing this combined territory and this combined intent to nest, and that's important for the future success of their nest and of their offspring. And so I have this great video here from Dan Ballard of Texas Wildlife that he shared with me the other day. I don't know if he's on here, but thank you, Dan, if you are. But this is a great video because it shows a lot of the kind of the courtship steps in great horned owl nesting behavior. So I'll give it a watch if we can. So sorry to interrupt, but what you're hearing here again is the duetting between a male and a female owl. The female has a slightly higher pitched vocalization, and the male's is a little bit more baritone, is a little deeper. This surprises some people. The female is also about a third larger than the male. So I believe this is the female here approaching the male on the right. And what they're doing again is called duetting, which in this case seems almost certain just to be establishing a territory. So they're just telling other owls to get out, that this is their area. And this is a potential nest site. This is an artificial nest that was constructed by Dan. And I think it's really interesting. You'll see the owls in this case, they'll both kind of stomp on it. They'll walk over it. The males are responsible for identifying a territory, nesting territory, and often for kind of identifying a potential nest sites. And after he finds these nest sites, he'll call to the female and she'll come inspect them. So just like you would if you were buying a house, the female likes to tramp on it, likes to sit in it, to test it out, to see whether or not it's a safe enough place for her to raise her owlets. I might be getting ahead of myself, but owls owls don't build their own nests. So they're looking for nests built by other birds, specifically by red-tailed hawks, by eagles. They're looking for a nest perhaps built by ravens. Sometimes they'll nest in squirrel nest or squirrel drays. And often they'll nest in crevices on trees, sometimes on cliffs, and sometimes even on the ground. So we'll watch this. You'll listen to the owls duetting. Again, the high-pitched one is the female, the baritone is the male. You'll see them stomping around the nest, and then you'll even see, I believe, the male bringing something to the female. So.
People can look for this though online, correct?
Yes, of course.
TexasBackyardWildlife.com.
Yep, that's it.
And Dan Ballard is on board. So hello, Dan, thank you for lending us this. And I'm sorry we didn't get it to run correctly.
Yeah, entirely my fault. What you saw in this video again is you saw the male and the female testing out the nest, so stomping all over it. Stepping into it, making sure that it's not going to fall apart. It looks like Dan did a good job of constructing it. You also saw the male and the female rubbing beaks together. And then finally, I think the final scene was quite nice with the male bringing his mate, a nice big rat. So it should be a lesson to all the potential, bachelors or whoever in the audience that need some help attracting a mate, is bringing somebody a good rat or something to eat may do the trick. So in that last video, you saw this great artificial nest that Dan built. But in the wild, they're not so lucky. And so again, owls will inhabit whatever nest they can find. They don't build their own nest in the landscape. And so in suburban and rural areas, you'll often find them in either hawk nest or actually in bald eagle nest in many parts of the country as well. So they'll fight hawks and they'll fight eagles for access to these breeding sites. And on the left, again, it looks like a great horned owl, a mother and an owlet. And it looks like probably a red-tailed hawk nest high up in a pine. On the right, this is a photo from someone in Arizona, I believe, who took this photo of owls nesting in a plant box outside of a church. So they'll nest wherever they can find a spot and wherever good territory they're able to locate. Fuzzy photos. So in the Arboretum, we've had mating owls in our landscape for years, and many of the people on the staff that have worked here for decades even have heard them and seen them for all these decades, which indicates that the arboretum is a favorable spot for owls. It's a good place for them to attempt to mate and to raise young. We never hear more than one pair, which again is an indication of how much territory these animals need, especially in urban areas where habitat is so fragmented. So in our 281-acre landscape, can pretty confidently say there's never any more than one breeding pair per season. And it led us a couple of years ago to hypothesize about owl available nesting habitat. The only place that we ever saw them nesting was in red-tailed hawk nest. And so with the help of our arborist, we decided to install some artificial owl nest in the shape of these platforms and in some plant baskets, which I'll show you in the next slide. And the hypothesis, at least, was, we know that owls will nest in a variety of different habitats. They'll actually nest at a variety of different heights in different types of trees in different locations. And so we were curious whether if we installed more of these artificial nest sites, whether it would increase the chances of attracting owls to nest in our landscape. And then selfishly, it would give us the opportunity to document the success or failure of their nesting attempts over time. And so this is just an example of one type of artificial nest platform that we installed in some of our trees. And so fortunately—
on the size of that, please?
I think it is roughly, just put another one up in the tree recently. I think it's like 3.5 by 3.5, maybe more. That's quite a large box. Much less beautiful, and definitely less beautiful than the one that Dan constructed. We also built these artificial nests using old planting baskets. And so in past years, we actually have had success attracting great horned owls to these kind of planting basket nest. And this is an example of a female sitting low in one of these baskets. And as I mentioned earlier, the nesting season for great horned owls typically starts, again, as early as October, November. You'll hear the males starting to define their territory. By December, they've definitely kind of matched up with potential mates. January, they're inspecting their nest sites. And then in most parts of the United States, late January through mid-February, great horned owls will have started nesting and will be on, already be on their eggs. Generally, I think by Valentine's Day is when most eggs of most great horned owls have been laid and the nesting process has begun. So again, just to emphasize, it's a good time of year to look for owls, mostly just because they're so vocal at this time of year. You'll hear them calling to define their territories and look for mates. They're in the landscape year round. They don't migrate. And most of their range, they don't migrate, except for maybe locally. But people associate them with the fall and winter primarily because that's when they're most noticeable. That's when they're most vocal. So the next few slides are just some shots from the nests that we had in past years and just examples of kind of the lifespan of these owls and owlets as they grow in the nest. So female owls will lay between 3 and 4 eggs per year, and they'll pull out patches of their own feathers. So you can see these feathers kind of lining this nest area, and they'll actually pull out patches of their feathers along their chest. So they have what's on their chest called a brood patch. So it's this naked layer of skin. On the owl's breast, and the female will lay down upon the eggs so that her skin is directly in contact with those eggs, and it keeps them nice and toasty, which is important given that obviously they're trying to incubate and raise these young in the wintertime. Let's see. The female will remain on the nest, will remain on her eggs for about a month, so over 30 days she'll stay on the nest. And during this time, she won't move. She'll try and stay on those nests, keeping those eggs as warm as possible for as long as she can. It's her job to stay on the eggs. Obviously, she can't hunt if she's incubating the eggs, day and night. And at that time, the male will bring her food. So he'll bring her food each evening. He'll even stash food in the trees around the nest site. So if he has excess food, he can bring it to her the following night. Or if she needs to leave, she can fly out and get it herself. So she'll be in constant contact with him. If predators or if a potential intruder comes into the nesting area, he'll call out to warn her. If she's attacked, which nesting owls often are, by hawks, sometimes by crows, will harass them. They'll rarely actually hurt them, but they'll harass them during the nesting season. The male will hoot in support and sometimes intervene to chase off potential intruders. So after about a month, the eggs begin to hatch. So in this case, there were three eggs and they hatch sequentially. So she lays them each one day apart and they each hatch one day apart. And you can see in this photo compared to the previous one I showed when she was so laid down, you can see now she's kind of sitting upright and her feathers are all kind of fluffed up. And so what she's doing now is she's actually brooding. So she's fluffing her chest feathers over the young who have hatched. When owls hatch, they're born altricial, which means they're born naked and blind. So they're kind of about the size of a fuzzy tennis ball is what the description would be. They can't see. They don't have many insulating feathers. So unless she's brooding them and keeping them warm continuously, then they have no chance of survival. So again, she's staying on the nest with these little owls all day and all night while the male brings her food. And then she'll use her bill and her talons to rip up food to feed to her young. So you see in this photo, now you can see this really little white fluff ball peeking over the side of the nest here. So this little owl is probably a little over 2 weeks old. Probably the eldest of its siblings. She's still on the nest and still brooding over at least one of the others. So after 2 weeks, they'll come out from under their mom. They'll start looking around, exploring a little bit. They still don't look anything like the adults. This one is going on, I think between 3 and 4 weeks old. So they grow very rapidly. And you can begin to see the barring on its feathers even at this young age. And it's amazing to think that one day it will look just like it's an adult, like its mother here. And I like this photo of Lucy's a lot just because of how it highlights the camouflage of these owls. So again, in the nesting season, they're very exposed. They're obviously very vulnerable. But if you just look at her feathers compared to the bark of the tree, it's just an indication of how when they're trying to be hidden during the day when they're roosting, of how well they can do that, and why it's obvious that it's so rare to see these owls in the wild. So growing older, still there's three little owlets in this nest. Again, this is probably the eldest one. You can see the barring is becoming a little bit darker. You can actually see the horn starting to grow in here on either side of its head. And then importantly, you can also see the facial disc is beginning to be a bit more defined. So it's starting to look a little bit more like a real owl. The mother is still in the nest all day with them, keeping constant watch. She doesn't want anything to come in there and grab them. At this time, when they're still small, other birds such as red-tailed hawks will absolutely try and come in, try and snatch one out if they can. The mother's there to prevent that from happening. You can see they're actually both looking up in the air right now. So they're observing other birds that are flying by. The male is still keeping watch from a nearby roost tree as well. Getting a little bit bigger, the female is still fluffed up on top of somebody. You can see how kind of triangular she looks in here. She hasn't gained any weight, but she's still just kind of poofed up to keep her owlets as warm as possible. And you can see it's rained in the background here. So she's doing her best to keep them warm while their insulating feathers grow in. It's getting a little bit bigger, or actually much bigger in this photo. I like this photo by Stevens because you can see on his wings, this young owlet, as they grow, they flap their wings, they get up, they walk around, they stretch. And flapping their wings is a really good way to exercise their wing muscles, to practice what will very quickly become a necessary part of survival. And you can see on this little guy's wings, you can see these little tubes right here. So these are just the pin feathers. These are still the pins that are holding their feathers in. So this owl's feathers are still developing. And as it ages, these kind of waxy sheaths will either start to crack and fall off, or the owlet will actively preen them off with its bill. But just an indication of how this owlet is maturing. Now going forward, I like this photo by Johns, just because it's something that you rarely see, which is just a completely soaking wet owl. And unlike other birds, owls don't have, great horned owls, I should say, don't have the ability to really waterproof their feathers. So they prefer just not to fly when it's raining. They'll huddle close to a tree trunk to try and avoid getting wet. And it really does look kind of like a wet cat to me. So another animal that doesn't really like to get soaked either. At this point, the young have enough of their insulating feathers that although it looks pretty miserable, it's probably nice and dry. I'm just waiting for the sun to come out to fluff out. So now you can see all three of the siblings. They're much older. These little owls are closer to six weeks old. And you can again see the very clearly defined now facial disc, the little nubs of horns that are poking out. And they're practicing their flying a lot more, they're flapping a lot more. They're still not flying. If you look closely, you can still see the sheaths that are covering the lower parts of their feathers. But they're very active. They're walking around the nest. And then notably, the female is no longer in the nest with them. So they've gotten so big that she doesn't really have too much space in there. And she's spending most of her time in a nearby tree, again, watching over them. So if another bird does come over, she'll absolutely fly in to protect them. At this point, she'll spend maybe part of the day with them, but again, it's getting a little too crowded. They're big enough to kind of support themselves. They have enough insulating feathers that they're not going to freeze. She doesn't need to spend all of her time with them. I mentioned earlier about food. So about, again, owls eating lots of rabbits, voles, mice. So each of these little guys is going to acquire several mice a night. So it's say like five or six mice per night. That's a lot of hunting. And so the male and the female are constantly hunting at night. They're trying to bring in as much food as they can to keep these growing owlets, keep this growing owlets alive. So just some close-up shots, again, just highlighting the facial disc. Their colors are beginning to grow in. These are called contour feathers. So you can see they're down, these little white feathers here, and then their contour feathers, these orange ones, are growing out that will provide their shape, their color of the more mature adult owls. Again, still getting older. Very active. They're walking all around the nest. They're preening, they're poking each other, fighting with one another, just like little kids. See the little nubs, their horns growing in. They're very attentive. So just like the female is attentive to threats near the nest, now these little guys are watching for all intruders that come nearby. Very curious of people. So it's another good reason not to spend too much time near the nest, as we don't want them to lose their fear of humans. But they're very curious of everything that's around their nest site now. So these guys are approaching 2 months old, which is nearly the time that they're going to fledge. And you can see how well developed they are since that first little white fuzzball photo. They're quite large. Their facial discs are developed. They're looking around, they're moving around, and they're flapping much, much more. And this compared to that previous photo with the barely developed feathers, now you can see that the wax sheaths are still a little bit left. This guy has still a little bit more development to go, but much bigger, much closer to flying. And if they left the nest at this point, it's not uncommon for young owls to either fall out of the nest. Sometimes they'll get pushed out by their siblings if there's not enough food to share. Sometimes they'll accidentally drop out. At this point, they could probably survive. So they'll spend, once an owlet goes to the ground, they actually have, very well-developed talons. They can crawl back up into nearby trees and in nearby bushes. And the parents will still take care of them even if they're on the ground. So it's important if you see an owl on the ground, especially in the spring, not to assume necessarily that it's been abandoned or is going to die. Often the parents are nearby, they're watching after it and they're looking over it. A couple more shots of this owl flapping its wings. So this is an example of the female bringing some food to the owlets. And sorry, I don't think there's any huge amount of sound here that you'll be missing, but I'm sorry for not having that context. And unlike earlier where she would have been ripping apart the food to feed them, she's still doing a little bit, but you can see that they're helping themselves. And fighting over her attention. And then this is a great video taken by Fran of these owlets practicing their flapping. And so as you saw those owlets kind of jumping up and down in the nest, and the wild, and perhaps even with their artificial nest, owls will reuse nest as long as they are able to, and as long as there's still safe places to attempt nesting. But they're very tough on their nest as well. So over time, the practice flapping, the continuous landing by the male and the female, will eventually break their nest down and make them unsafe for the owls to use. So at this point, these owls are all quite large. While they cannot fly just yet, so this little owl, or this owl, for example, won't be able to fly out of the nest perfectly. After this stage, again, about 2 months, they'll do what is called branching. So they'll start climbing out onto the lateral branches, which all three of these young owls did or attempted to do. They'll climb out on these lateral branches and then try and climb into two surrounding trees to get out of the nest. So at this point, it's almost too dangerous to stay there. They're too big for the nest. They're too big of a mark for a potential predator. So they start moving into surrounding trees and start taking short practice flights. And during the early days of their flights, they can usually do about 3 or 4 flights per night, and then it will get progressively more and progressively longer. And so the owls in this slide, again, started nesting in February. The eggs hatched around March, April, May, they were out of the nest. The parents will take care of them through the summer and into the fall. Both the male and the female will watch out for them. We'll bring them food. We'll teach them how to hunt and kind of oversee and make sure that they're safe from any predators. And by the fall, they're large enough to hunt on their own. And the male owl or their father will eventually chase them out of his territory if they haven't left on their own. So he begins to see them as competitors rather than just offspring. And they'll be forced out of his territory and into surrounding neighborhoods or out of the city into surrounding parks to look for territories of their own to start the nesting process over again.
One question is, this owl is in the genus Bubo with the, the European eagle owl. So one question was, what makes them different from other owls?
An interesting question. Yeah, so the name of the great horned owl is Bubo virginianus. Bubo is just the genus. So there are lots of other owls that are related to great horned owls, and virginianus is, of course, the species. And so what makes them different? So I guess there are a lot of genetic differences between these species. There's also when you're doing species classification, you're looking at the physical differences. It's an interesting question about like animal and species classification, but generally originally broke down along just physical and visual differences, and now it's more along DNA as well.
Okay. Thank you. So I've been taking notes on the various questions that have come in. Are there barred owls at the Arnold Arboretum?
There are barred owls at the Arboretum.
Are they competitors?
Barred owls? So they're actually not competitors. As I mentioned earlier, great horned owls will eat anything they can catch. Barred owls are a little bit smaller, and so their prey items tend to be a little bit smaller. So they're definitely not necessarily competing for the same resources as great horned owls. And alternatively, great horned owls will eat barred owls. So they're competitors in the sense that barred owls try to stay away from areas where there are lots of great horned owls or where they might overlap.
Okay.
But there are, every year we have about, I'd say a couple barred owls are seen in the Arboretum. And it seems like it's mostly like a winter local migration. They'll come to the city from the suburbs and from more rural areas. And the idea behind that, or the hypothesis behind that, is that they're looking for more food in the wintertime. And the city, we have lots of rats, we have lots of mice, other critters that are running around our parks. And so that might be one thing that attracts barred owls in the winter.
Great. Is climate change affecting their nesting and courtship, do you think?
That's a really good. It's a really good question. I don't know. I don't know the exact answer of how climate change is affecting their courtship. I do know there have been some studies that show that owls that nest in urban areas tend to nest earlier than their rural counterparts, and that might be possible factors into that, or that cities tend to be a little bit warmer due to the urban heat island effect. And so as the climate changes, it could be, I mean, you could start to see owls nesting a little earlier. I'm not quite sure how that will be. Great horned owls will probably not be horribly effective just because of how adaptive and widespread they currently are, but their prey certainly might be,
okay,
which would have impacts on the owls.
Are they, this is a question from a six-year-old who observed that the owl in the video, they were moving around during the day. Is that something that happens, that they're active during the day as well as during the night?
That's a really good observation. So they're most active at night. Owls are nocturnal, and great horned owls, again, are most active around night. You can see them during the daytime if you're out around dusk, and around dawn are kind of the best times to see them in the light. Sometimes they'll take advantage of that dying or just beginning light to go hunting or to start their vocalizing. In my experience, that's the best time to listen for them as well. And during the mating season, like that video, the video that we showed where the male and the female were kind of playing around or walking around on the nest in the daytime, during the mating season, they're just more active generally, and you might have a better chance to see them in the daytime, but usually towards the evenings. So otherwise, in the daytime, they tend to roost and to hide in dense trees where they can't be seen.
Do you have any idea how large an owl's territory is?
It changes based on the conditions of the environment. So again, at the Arboretum, we have 281 acres and only one breeding pair. So I would guess that in urban environments, the owls are defending as much territory as they can get. Maybe in rural environments, I'm not quite sure, but it's certainly hundreds of acres is probably not far off for each individual breeding pair. During the non-breeding season, there's more overlap, so they're not as aggressive towards one another.
Could you talk a little bit about the nest? So where is the best place to find details on building owl nests? And with regard to that basket nest, did you put anything in it, or did the owl fill that?
That's a great question. So as far as building nest, there are lots of resources out there. You can look at a really good website is all about birds. So the Cornell Lab of Ornithology has a great website for bird watching, and also has a section of all about birds focuses on nest building. And so you can find schematics for building a nest on that website. The platform nest we built were adapted from a scientific survey done for great gray owls, which great horned owls were found to nest in as well. And as far as the basket nest goes, we fill both the platforms and the baskets with a mix of wood shavings and sticks. the owls don't bring anything into the nest with them. So they don't put any effort into making nest or into padding nest besides maybe making a little divot for the eggs and the female putting some feathers down. But otherwise they don't bring anything with them.
Okay. Do you know of any monitoring programs for tracking the owlets after they leave the nest?
So Mass Audubon has, I'm sure there are actually plenty, but Mass Audubon has, in particular, we'll put tags on the young owls. And so there's some researchers there that for a few nests, they'll climb up into the tree and put some just leg bands on the young owlets. And the purpose of this, that the leg bands are non-invasive. They don't hurt the owlets. They don't slow them down or penalize them in any way as they age. But it does allow researchers to determine where they're going, how far they go from their nest, what types of territories they're defending. So there are research programs. And Mass Audubon's a good place to look.
At what age can you tell the male from the female?
Fairly early. So even leaving the nest, the female owlets will tend to be larger. So even leaving the nest, the female owlets are larger than their male siblings. Within the first few months, the size difference will begin to be notable. And the females are about a third, mature females are about a third larger than the males.
What happens with all of their excretions in the nest?
Great question.
Going to the nest, someone is saying that they've seen adults excrete from branches, and it's quite a bit of white and yellow substance.
I was trying to go quickly, just out of concern for time. But these are great questions. So owls are known for producing owl pellets. So when they eat prey, like we saw in that video, the female was scarfing down a rat. They'll puke out the bones and the fur and the non-digestible bits into an owl pellet. And so if you go near a common roosting tree, or certainly this nest tree, there were dozens and dozens of owl pellets underneath the tree. And the young owls will do the same thing. They'll cough up their owl pellets. The parts of their prey that is digested comes out as excrement. And that is, like whoever in the comments noted, is usually white. And so a way to find owls in common roost trees is to look for, it's called whitewash. So it's owl poop that kind of stains the side of the trees or the foliage. And with the little owls, I think it's good to wonder, like, hopefully they're not just pooping in their nest. You know, that would be kind of disgusting after a while. And so they're, I guess it's not trained. Thankfully, they instinctually point their rear ends over the edge of the nest when they need a poop as owlets, so it doesn't just fill up the base of the nest that they're in.
Someone's wondering where were the cameras or the photographers who were taking these pictures, how close? I know that in some of them, John was up in a lift.
Yeah. So
other photographers are on the ground, right?
Yeah. So as I mentioned in the beginning, it's we put these nests up kind of for like a scientific purpose, just to see whether or not we can encourage more owls nesting in the landscape. We didn't necessarily anticipate that so many people would be interested in photographing them, which is a bit naive in hindsight. And so these photos are actually all taken from the ground. The tree just happens to be in a location where you can see fairly easily into the nest site. But all these photos were taken from at least, I think I measured it out, at least 100 yards away. So as soon as we realized that the owls were nesting in this artificial nest, we put up a fence line to prevent people from getting closer, and tried to make it just so that photographers were as non-intrusive as possible. And even so, the owls are still very wary and still just continuously tracking people as they walk through the landscape. But all these photos were taken on the ground, except for the one with the eggs. That one was taken by one of our arborists who went up to tie some more supports onto the nest. So the nest seemed like there's some structural issues when they first started using it. But generally, you'd never disturb the nest. And fortunately, as soon as he came back down out of the tree, the female went right back onto the eggs. But we decided in that case it was better than the alternative.
Do you know what a typical lifespan of an owl would be?
They can live quite long, but I think like 20 years is kind of the maximum, especially in the wild. But I think also important to note that the young owl, so the owlets that left the nest in this case, the lifespan for a young owl is on average very short. So it's something up to at least 75% of each year's new owlets die before their first year. So it's really hard to be a juvenile owl. Most of them starve. It's hard to catch that much food, and it's hard to learn. It's hard to learn to be a successful hunter. So the mortality rate for first year owls is quite high. But as they age, the risk of them dying goes down.
Mm-hmm. Is three the typical number of eggs for the great horned owls?
Three or four is the average number of eggs in a clutch.
And do they ever push a baby out? Do they do this, feed the biggest one and ignore the others?
So I don't know of any cases where the adults have pushed out one of their young. That is common in some other species of birds, but I've never read of anything about the adult owls committing infanticide, pushing out their offspring. But that is definitely the case with their siblings. So we actually had an incidence of this a couple years ago where if there's not enough food, the larger of the owlets will often push out the younger ones. So again, they won't eat it, but they'll push the younger ones out of the nest in order to monopolize food from the adults. And a couple of years ago, our arborist rescued an owl that was pushed out of a tree and put it right back up in the nest. And then I believe John said that like 30 minutes later, it was back out on the ground again. Hmm.
I remember hearing that.
Yeah.
Do humans have any reason to fear owls? The great horned owls, do they attack at all?
If you were attacked by a great horned owl, it would only be because you were harassing the nest or directly attacking the owl. So they will not attack you unless you're endangering them, in which case I think it's fair enough that they go for it. So for example, if you're getting too close to the tree, which is another reason we put up the roping, and the male thought that you were going to endanger the female or the owlets, the male might fly down and attack you for sure. But it's not a normal occurrence to be attacked by a great horned owl.
Are there other owls in the arboretum?
Yeah, so we have great horned owls. Someone asked earlier, we have barred owls and screech owls are three species that are seen in the arboretum. Another owl would be the saw-whet owl, which has never been confirmed in the landscape, but is almost certainly in the landscape as well. So three or four species.
And then I think, could you go over the proper etiquette for walking owls and not disturbing them and just run through that list again? That would be great.
Sure. You want me to bring it up again?
Yeah.
All right, we'll do that.
And while Brendan's doing that, I just want to mention that if you want to watch the video that we tried to share with you, it was done by Dan Ballard, and it is found at texasbackyardwildlife.com. That's texasbackyardwildlife.com.
Yeah, and thanks again for Dan. He actually sent that video especially for this presentation, so it was very kind of him to do that. Sorry again for the sound. Yeah, so again, if you're owling in the landscape, these are kind of our arboretum guidelines, and I think generally good ethical guidelines for observing owls. So please don't post photos on social media. Please don't post nest photos to social media. So that includes, obviously, Facebook, Instagram, but I would even say that includes things like eBird for you birders out there. It's just generally not good birding etiquette to put photos of nesting birds, especially owls, on the internet. Please don't play recordings. If you see them, just speak softly and walk slowly. Try to limit your visits and consider the impact of the whole visiting public. And then as Pam said, if you did want to go looking for owls, that's not too hard wherever you live. If you go out in the evening around this time of year, right before it's getting dusk, and just listen, you can usually hear them. If you live in a suitable habitat, you have a chance of hearing them calling. And while you may not see them, I think the listening to them is quite a nice experience as well. So again, if you don't take anything else away from this presentation, I would please ask that you remember these guidelines and think about the wildlife that we're observing.
All right, thank you everybody. I just want to also mention the Cornell website again. That is all about birds. I know I saw lots of questions about how to deal with the, if you're building a nest, how to deal with that and whether to fill it, et cetera. So you should do some research on that website and find out what they recommend for height of the nest and what you line it with, et cetera. So lots of information again at All About Birds by the Cornell Lab of Ornithology. And again, that video is at texasbackyardwildlife.com. So thank you very much, Brendan. Thank you all for participating and writing in wonderful questions to keep the dialogue going. And I hope to see you soon at our next MOB. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.